We're continuing YouTube Week in partnership with Library, and joining me today is a parody video maker, an objectivist, and a guy who lost his blue check mark on Twitter. Rucka Rucka Ali, welcome to the Rubin Report.
Hey, thanks for having me. We're inside the internet. This is crazy.
We are in the internet right now.
Yeah, surreal.
You live in the internet, though.
Yeah, in a way I do.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I'm feeling that my hair is very flat. Because sitting across from you with that high hair.
Well, you know, I'm trying to bring our heights to be about the same, so.
Yeah.
Thanks for keeping it low for me.
Yeah, maybe by the end I'll pop it a little bit
we'll
more.
We'll see how pissed off we can make you, how aggravated.
So first off, I've watched a ton of your stuff over the years, but I watched probably 10 of your videos this morning, and you're doing just great stuff. I mean, funny, edgy, like actually edgy comedy, which comedy basically seems dead to me these days. So I'm starting this interview with a compliment.
Thank you.
How do you feel about that?
Well, I feel great to hear that you endorse everything I've ever posted online.
100% endorsement,
and
everything.
You know, comedy is like stand-up comedy. It's just all this self-deprecating shit, with exceptions. There are some talented folks out there. But in general, I think the internet pretty much is the new home for comedy.
Yeah. So, all right. First off, before anything else, I don't know your real name. I don't know, unless your name is Rucka.
Yeah.
But I feel that perhaps your name is not Rucka. I don't know that anyone knows your real name. I mean, I did work research here.
Mm-hmm.
What's Rucka?
I mean, I looked myself up on Wikipedia, and there's a name on there.
It's on there?
I don't know if it's my real name or not. I'd rather not share that info, maybe in a future interview. But other than that, I'm going to be pretty open book with you, which is a new thing, which is going to be very rare.
Okay. All right. Mm-hmm. Cool. Well, we have met once or twice before, and we've talked. We had a pretty good political talk in the middle of an afternoon.
Philosophical, absolutely.
A very philosophical political discussion.
Yeah.
But before we dive too much into that part of this, where did Rucka? Where did this avatar, this character, this alternate person in the internet come from?
I guess I was. I loved rap. I loved like comedy rap, like old school Eminem. Like the first time I heard "Hi, my name is Slim Shady" on the radio, I was 11. That just like changed everything for me. And I always wanted to do comedy rap, and 2006 started doing like comedy crunk rap, crunk. You know, like Lil Jon with the chains and the craziness, everything's over the top, overselling everything. So started posting music on MySpace, and it was just like overselling everything. And then a couple years later, parody became a big part of the game. I posted one parody on YouTube, and it blew up by 2008 standards, by my standards. It got 25,000 views.
Whoa!
In 5 days.
Back then,
I was like, so I'm set for life. I was like, I was like, that's it. Yeah. Like, I'm doing this forever. So,
were you monetized at that time?
There was like AdSense, and it was like at the bottom of the screen. And when they first started doing ads at the beginning of videos, like those 30-second ads or even the skippable ones, I remember wondering, like, is this going to slow down traffic? Because people might just click away from the video altogether.
Yeah.
But yeah, I was excited about the parody blowing up. And then a friend of mine said, so are you just going to be like a parody rapper now? And I was like, no. Well, you know, 8, 9, 10 years later, here we are.
Yeah.
That's mostly what I'm known for. But there is kind of this rapper, you know, character beneath that.
Yeah. Well, let's show some of the people some of the parody. This is a bit you did. It's less than 2 minutes. I think it's around 1:40. This is you doing a little of that parody that you do when I had Blair White and Candace Owen on the show.
Rucka Ali.
Hey.
Guys, 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 guys.
Epic rap battle
jumping
shower.
Guys, guys.
Red white versus red bro.
Fight.
This ain't a cat fight, bitch. You a grown man,
bitch.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
Make me a sandwich.
Guys.
I ain't done yet, bitch. Let me finish.
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 Guys, guys.
You a dog's ass, bitch.
It's a splash site.
What? I'ma fuck you up the head with the flashlight.
Guys.
Tell your crew I don't negotiate with terrorists. I'm the hardest conservative from Connecticut.
Why did you invite me here to debate me? Can't find a black bitch as shook as you in Haiti.
Great. Well, you can find your old bull bullshit on me. Try finding a bitch sneaking into your party.
I so wanna be here with you too, reminding me why I started banging dudes.
This bitch so crazy.
This girl is a guy.
Guys, is the world strange enough? 2017, you couldn't make this up.
Tell us who paid you.
This is a lowlife.
Guys.
Who won? Who's next? You decide. Epic Wage Gap Battle of Heroes.
Hey, Bucka, what's the deal with the second verse?
Oh, the second verse.
Are you doing this? I'm still a little confused about the second verse. We'll get to that in a second. But all right, so I wanted to show people that to kind of get a gist of what you do. When you saw that, that showdown that we had on the show, were you immediately like, I got to do something with this? Like, how does that? How does the idea usually pop for you?
You know, it's case by case. Creativity, it just kind of hits you how it hits you. Are you a writer?
Working on a book.
Yeah, I mean, you can never trace it back to where it began. But yeah, the memes definitely kind of pushed me to do it.
Yeah, I realized as we were watching that you know, we do this as an audio podcast also, and people are going to be hearing that without the video. I wonder if that changes it's going to change the comedy at some level.
On some level, yeah.
On some very, very deep level. All right, so you started around 2006.
Yeah.
You were on MySpace.
Yeah.
What was MySpace?
It was like the first type of social media, I think, that brought everyone onto the internet. Like, I know people that wouldn't even go online before in MySpace. Mm-hmm. They just thought the internet was totally lame and a waste of time. And I was kind of like that too. I mean, I loved like AOL, like talking to people online tripped me out. Like, whoa, it's in real time. But other than, and there were some memes like Homestar Runner and stuff like that. But for the most part, like marketing myself online, MySpace changed everything. As much as we make fun of it now, it really was a game changer. And yeah, I still think it sucks that we went over to Facebook instead.
Yeah.
I'd rather have stayed.
Why is that?
Why would I have rather stayed?
Yeah.
Because MySpace, you can sort of design it and tell the world who you really are, you know, by listing all your favorite songs and stuff. Whereas Facebook, it's just a picture and just, you know, comments and stuff.
Yeah. What do you make of the state of all of social media in general right now? Facebook, Twitter, the YouTube, the whole thing.
Everyone's trying to be everything. So now like YouTube is trying to be Twitter, where you can post tweets to your followers, and Twitter at some point probably will have music. And yeah, it's like everyone's trying to do everything. Twitter is gonna have like original series pretty soon. I'm actually, I'm auditioning for a Dropbox series later today. So I'm look forward to that.
Yeah, I honestly don't know if you're kidding. That's the level.
That's where we're at.
That's the level. It's like, yes, yeah. Dropbox, comedy. Like,
pretty much.
Why not?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Is it funny for you to meet people in the real world that know what you do because you are sort of an internet person?
Doesn't happen that often. I mean, I'm living in Hollywood, where they still haven't quite gotten the memo about new media.
Yeah.
And yeah, I don't know. My face is not in the videos that much. So in a way, it's like I don't get recognized too often or anything like that. But yeah, I don't know. Yeah, some people occasionally people have stared at me like. Like they're
that might be the hair.
Like that
hair.
That could be it. Or like, I mean, people that I've met who are fans, like they've tried to like kind of gauge like what the deal is. But yeah, I know it's that the stuff I'm posting online is a little bit over the top at times, I've been told.
So. Yeah. Yeah. Well, you do teeter on that, where it's like you're going edgy and over the top at the same time. Do you ever worry about some of the backlash? Because, you know, you're talking about feminism and you're talking about the SJWs and all that stuff.
Not so much. I don't really. That's more what you guys talk about, you commentary people. I'm mostly just joke about like stereotypes and stuff like that. It's very 90s urban. It's Chris Rock and Dave Chappelle. So. I may be, in some people's minds, affiliated with, you know, the Kekistani community, whatever the fuck, but that's not really so much. I think I reach a much more general audience. In some cases, slightly younger, apolitical, kind of maybe college-bound, but they haven't gone yet audience. So a lot of people have no idea that this whole culture war is going on. They're just like, you know, when the U.S. stormed the beaches of France, there were people just hanging on the beach that they didn't realize World War II was about to end.
Yeah.
Or maybe they didn't even know there was anything called World War II in some cases. They're at the beach. So that's my audience. They're just here to have fun.
Do you think we're really in the midst of like a massive culture war or something even bigger than that?
There's a lot of new, there's something very new and something very not new about what's going on. There's a big chunk of the left broke off. I put you in that category. A lot of the Gamergate people, guys like Sargon, I call you guys displaced lefties. And you guys are like looking for a new home. And it's weird that like probably for the first time ever, like communism is an insult. Like communism is called bad. It's not edgy. Yeah. The edgelords are making fun of communism. That's new. At the same time, there's nothing new to see here because this isn't the first time left-leaning people notice that the left is crazy. The left has always eaten its own. Leftism is a philosophy of cannibals, at least the old left. The socialism is industrialized cannibalism. And then the new left, the hippies up to Antifa, they're just naked nihilists. They just want to smash things and destroy things and occasionally pay lip service to some bright future, but that's really not what they're about. So the people have been leaving the left for a long time, or at least growing disillusioned with it and not really understanding why it's happening the way it is and kind of looking for a new home. And more often than not, they end up on the right, you know, conservatism, whatever that means at that time. Today, conservatives, there's the branch of them that are kind of the religious, America's founding principles, at least they say they are. I don't think conservatives are. But there's that, and then there's the ethno-conservatives. And the two have always, for a long time, been aligned. So the conservatives, the conservative movement has never pushed away, at least in recent times, haven't pushed away people like Pat Buchanan and Ann Coulter that are a bit too focused on ethnicity, for my taste. So there's always been those two sides of the right. And since a lot of you guys are atheists, I project you guys are going to end up nationalist, either ethno-nationalists or very flirty with it. And you guys, yeah, like Donald Trump is definitely your guy. He's a nationalist, he's unprincipled, and just a complete pragmatist who speaks about this country like the world is a no-sum game and it's just a matter of which country can screw over which country first.
So when you say you guys, take it you don't include yourself in that crew.
No. Yeah. I don't include myself in that crew because I at one point was similarly a displaced lefty. How far back do we go?
Take us back.
Okay,
us back.
So I was born in Israel, in Jerusalem, in a very religious upbringing, very religious environment. Mm-hmm. Americans would call it Orthodox. Over there, we just call it religious. There's just religious and secular.
Yeah.
And I walked away from that at a pretty young age and became very nihilistic, very kind of sympathetic to all aspects of the left, like the radical environmentalists and the animal rights aspect of the left, and just the communists, pretty much anything that wasn't, I realize now that anything besides capitalism is cool. Because ultimately, there's capitalism and then there's everything else. There's just pure unadulterated individual rights and everything that looks like politically, and then there's everything that's just looking for a way to get rid of that, the way I see it now. Mm-hmm. But I didn't really have a coherent view of things, but I was so nihilistic and I was just so mad at the world. But I was sort of, I'm like trying to collect my thoughts. So I was kind of torn between these two options. There was religion on one hand, and then there was kind of this vulgar materialism on the other. And when I say materialism, I don't mean like love of diamonds. I mean like the communist materialism, like we're just material beings, we're just a collection of atoms with no consciousness, no personal values. We're just automatons being driven by forces outside of our consciousness. And that's pretty much presented as the two options. There's religion, which, you know, says you're special and you're an individual and you have free will, but it's religious, so it rests on a mystical base. And then there's materialism, which says, hey, life has no real meaning and you're basically a robot, but hey, at least it's not religion. That was kind of presented as the two options. And I obviously didn't want to be religious, so I just kind of ended up settling on this very gratuitous kind of pleasure-seeking way of life and view of the world. It's kind of like, yeah, we're here. We're life is short. Who knows what's even real? I mean, I was smoking a lot of weed and taking a lot of hallucinogens and just partying hard and going through all these motions in my head that I realize now modern philosophers have been doing for centuries. But you know, who
you
knows?
Mean you didn't come up with all of it.
It's weird. I think the academic level that people like Kant and Hegel are able to break all these things down obviously is outside of my capacity, but I think the motions of what you go through when you accept this dichotomy of religion on one side and materialism on the other, you kind of end up playing these mind games that I think a lot of people kind of go through, and hallucinating probably doesn't help matters, and being a frustrated teenager doesn't help either. So yeah, I see the same two options being presented today in today's landscape. On one hand, you've got Ben Shapiro saying everything good about the world comes from religion and the only meaning in life comes from religion. On the other hand, you've got people like, I'll just name Jordan Peterson just because he comes to mind and his fans hate when I talk about him, that you're basically shaped by evolution. Evolution determined that we're going to have this conversation. Evolution gave us certain ideas, you know, from birth, passed to us from past generations. And I might be getting something wrong about what it is that he's about. He yeah. confuses
me. Well, he also has the religious element involved.
Yeah, here. So there's a lot of hybrids, a lot of kind of the clashing of the two. So but those are basically the two options. Either you have free will, but God gave you that free will, or you have no free will. You're just an automaton. You're just a material being chasing either pleasure or doing what society conditioned you to do, and or evolution conditioned you to whatever it is. It's never the secular world does not offer any grounds for the existence of free will until I read Ayn Rand, who she said she just basically knocks. She just says, let's just start from square one. She starts with just the very basic levels of philosophy, and she arrives at the conclusion and demonstrates how religion is wrong, and I was right about that. Mysticism is wrong, and people do have free will. We are conscious, and yeah,
this is interesting because I was definitely going into that route. I didn't realize we were going to get there so quickly, but I can see that's where your head's at. So we're going to, we're just going down that road then. So it's interesting. Okay, so first you presented that sort of you guys, meaning me and probably the people that, a lot of the people that watch this, that we're going to sort of get caught between, how did you describe it exactly? We're going to get caught between
religion on one side and materialism on the other.
But in a political sense, what does that
mean? Yeah, so politically, you get to choose between Ben Shapiro and, sorry to be an extremist, but Richard Spencer, on the other hand. Even if you don't ever end up like perfectly in his camp, what he's offering is the atheist version of the right today.
Right.
It's your identity, your he doesn't speak of consciousness very much, but your identity comes from your race, blood and soil.
So basically what you're saying is that accepting that the left went bananas leaves you just with whatever's left on the right now, and that's either the sort of Ben Shapiro side of it, of conservatism, or I don't know that I would say it's the Richard Spencer part, but it's probably the Trump part, right? Like the Spencer part, whatever. It's just this little sliver.
What's the difference between Richard Spencer and any conservative that's saying we need to pay attention to the demographics, to the birth rate of whites? I mean, ultimately he's taking their premises and taking them to their logical extreme. And that's another thing that Rand taught me to do. She said, look at ideas in terms of what does this look like when taken to its logical extreme? Because the nature of ideas is they do get carried out to their logical extreme. We see that in politics more clearly than anywhere. 120 years ago, somebody said, hey, let's feed the poor. The government can feed the poor. Sure, okay, yeah, we'll all pay a 10% tax and have a very basic safety net. Flash forward to today. You're paying 60% in taxes and, you know, the so-called poor are, you know, they have two meals a day paid for by, you know, on their bridge card. So it's like, ideas do get taken to their logical extreme. It's not even a slippery slope. It's just the nature of principles.
Yeah.
If you see the basic premises, it gets taken to its logical extreme.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting to me because it's one of the things that I'm definitely concerned about these days for sure is, okay, we've gotten to the place where I think most people, most thinking people, be it real liberals or conservatives or libertarians or whatever, kind of accept that the left has gone bananas. But you're right, you have to say, all right, well, what's your new home then? And really, what does it look like if you take it to its nth place?
Yeah.
And I would say I don't know that those are exactly what the two choices are. You have to choose between, you know, religion and that sort of ethno-nationalism. I think there is a home for sort of enlightenment values and real liberalism. I just don't know where that is exactly.
I do know where it is. You probably can guess where I think it is. But those Enlightenment values are individualistic.
Yeah.
Those Enlightenment values rely on philosophical premises. See, people are so compartmentalized.
So this is where you'd say objectivism is the answer.
It is the answer.
Okay.
So people are compartmentalized as well. So you can convince somebody of something that a certain political course would be the right way to do it, but like if philosophically they can't back that up, like with their ethical beliefs, it's just not going to happen. You know, I have a bit of a chip on my shoulder from my religious upbringing, as you can probably guess,
yeah.
but I do think that being educated the way I was left me with a skill for integrating and for kind of tying different categories together in a way that I'm thankful to have gone through what I did, as opposed to if I had gone to like a public school in America, where the mode of education out here teaches you to disintegrate. It teaches you to put everything in a different box that are unrelated to one another. So like in politics, I mean, it's hard to get people to even understand that, you know, clean your room, as Peterson say, means you might get a promotion at work. Well, what the fuck does that have to do? That's the point. Everything ties to everything. And in politics, if say I convince you that socialized medicine is a bad idea, and you say, okay, fine, I get it, but surely education should still be free. Okay, now we need to have the same conversation about education. You say, okay, but surely the poor should get food stamps. It's like, and by the time we're done talking about that, you already forgot about socialized medicine and you're back. Ultimately, everything needs to be integrated. Everything needs to be tied to everything. And every branch of philosophy needs to be tied to the other. So politics is not its own philosophy. Politics, it needs to rest on ethics. Mm-hmm. Ethics rests on epistemology and metaphysics, aka knowledge and existence.
Yeah, well, that is why I talk mostly about political philosophy here, instead of the day-to-day machinations of politics. Because to me, that just makes everyone dumber all the time. It's like, you see what Trump tweeted, now the Democrats say this, the Republicans say this, and it's like, no one actually learned anything, and you're fighting the same battles over and over and over again, and we're all dumber for it.
Yeah.
But tell me a little bit about that education, though, that you did get. Was that a religious education?
Oh, yeah, very religious. Very religious. From a very young age, I was going to all boys schools. My educators before first grade were typically young women with probably themselves had not been super educated, even religiously, so they were just kind of passing along whatever it is that they were passing along, such as things that sounded downright Catholic. Looking back, you go to hell if you break the rules.
You heard that from Orthodox Jews.
Oh yeah,
right. I thought there is no hell.
Well, I think that's just a Woody Allen version of Judaism. Yeah.
Oh, is that right?
I was told very clearly.
Yeah.
Because otherwise I would not have been on board with it.
Yeah.
I was like, why should I go to synagogue on Saturday morning while other kids are watching cartoons? Well, I don't want to get punished, do I?
Yeah.
I don't want to go to hell. So, but it was like a different type of hell. It was like when you die, everything you've ever done is weighed on a scale, I was told. And if you did more good than bad, you go to heaven. If you did more bad than good, you go to hell, but only until your debt is repaid, like until you're neutral or something. I don't know. It was and no two people agree. You know, no two religious thinkers have the same. I mean, no two people in general really agree. So, I was told kind of contrasting things, but yeah, so that, I mean, that's how I was educated. Very religious, very superstitious, and
So when you see the Ben Shapiro part of this,
that
comes from religion, but probably, I would guess, but correct me if I'm wrong, that you probably agree with him on a ton politically.
Well, not where it counts, honestly. I don't know where he stands on like antitrust and breaking up monopolies and all that, but I haven't seen him go after Papa Prager. So Prager is suing Google and YouTube, and as far as I've seen, on the grounds that YouTube is a public forum.
Yeah.
If Ben Shapiro doesn't agree with him, he certainly isn't calling him out. So I don't think Ben Shapiro could ever say he's a capitalist. Capitalism is just the general vibe that he's about. But yes, I do tend to agree.
Just to be clear, to make sure people know what you're talking about. So PragerU is in a lawsuit with YouTube or Google at the moment about restricting their videos and trying to figure out what's actually going on with the algorithm. Mm-hmm. We've talked about this a little bit on the show, and I'm kind of, I'm struggling with this one because my libertarian side says no good can come of the government being involved in this.
But,
and then there's another part of me that says this, that Google is now so big and Google's the number one search engine and YouTube's the number two search engine, and this monstrosity is so large and it controls so much information that perhaps the government is the only thing that can fix it. And so I don't really believe that second one.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm
there's always a but. Listen, and this is the nature
of... This is not an easy one.
Well, it is an easy one, but like this is the nature of ideas. If you allow this much of a contradiction, the irrational side of that contradiction will eventually take hold. It really is like mixing poison with food. The poison is going to win.
So your answer would be basically that capitalism
deregulate, and for bonus points, deregulate the finance sector, the sector of the economy that we all love to hate. The hatred of bankers and financiers, honestly, can only be described as medieval. Like this knee-jerk reaction to just this hatred of people, these paper shuffling bankers. It's basically anti-Semitism adapted to the 21st century. There's no rational reason to hate financiers, but we love to regulate them. We love to cut off their balls and make their life difficult. So honestly, let the money pour into Silicon Valley. Let all sectors of the economy go free, and the internet will rise and get cooler even faster than it is. But I want to go back to anyway, that's my opinion. The government has no business regulating private industry, and to the extent that the government is in bed with Google, that's the problem. We need to divorce the two.
Right. So that,
no
that's
favors.
Where
yeah,
I'm
but
at,
when
basically.
People start to justify further government intervention by saying, "Hey, that the Google gets favors from the government, so Google is public property," and so now we're just making it worse. We need to work it the other way back. And the reason we won't reverse it, just like with net neutrality, is as much as we say we hate the government, we hate companies more. We hate businessmen. We hate businessmen like Nazis hated the Jews. It's just, we turn on a TV, a businessman is pulling a gun on somebody every other turn. They're the most likely to be committing murder on a TV show. Businessmen, it's like it goes without saying. Whenever you bring up like that businessman, it's just, oh yeah, businessmen are all shysters. They're all dishonest. They're all pieces of shit. But there's so much. I want to talk about Ben Shapiro for a second. I tend to agree with a lot of his analyses and stuff like that, but ultimately what he's selling is a worldview that says without God, it's all meaningless. He's saying he's really ultimately rejecting personal values in its deepest form, and it's like he and I passed each other in the night. I think he was born into a secular family, and now he's going around telling people that there's no such thing as love.
Haven't heard that one.
Maybe he was trying to be funny. I would not suggest he do that, but he said on Adam Carolla's show once that the purpose of marriage is children. Not love. You've heard that. Love. The way he mocks the word. Love. Don't marry for love. But he says the purpose of marriage is children. He says he literally said, it's not for love. I could get love downtown for $20. That's love in his mind. Love is what you get from a prostitute for $20. And if he wants to say that atheists are cynical, if he thinks we're materialistic, he's dismissing one of the most basic values that people pursue in life. He's reducing marriage down to just basically an arrangement. So that's the message I get from him. And I spotted it right away, because that's kind of a lot of what I heard growing up. And that's a lot of what kind of made me disgusted and want to walk away.
Well, for the record, he's the first guest on the 2018 Rubin Report. Ooh. So I will follow up with some of this love stuff.
Good. He needs to be confronted.
In a case like his, though, if he doesn't care, at the end of the day, I mean, when he sat in that chair and we talked about gay marriage, he basically was like, well, I don't want the government involved.
Yeah.
I accept that as a perfectly fine place of arguing or or rationality. So then what's the difference, really? You know what I mean? Like, he has his private beliefs.
Yeah.
Okay, but he's not trying to convert anybody. He's not trying to bring anyone into the fold. I'm sure he'd be happy if people converted, but he's definitely not trying to do that. So if his public beliefs line up with most of the libertarian stuff that you believe. Now, we don't have to make this really about
him. We can talk about him all day. Yeah. Maybe the next red pill black debate can be me versus Ben Shapiro.
Yeah. Who's going to do the parody video of that one?
That's confusing. I don't know. But, I forgot.
That he's not trying to convert anybody.
Politically, he's far from the worst. He's one of the best. For a conservative, he's much more philosophical than a lot of them. Mm-hmm. However, politics does rest on philosophy, specifically ethics. The reason that the libertarians can never win, the reason that the free market forces never seem to win, we're always moving away from them. We have brief stints of kind of deregulation and lower taxes, but it's always followed by a bigger pendulum swing back towards socialism, back towards big government. And even the free market types in DC and in the political landscape, they tend to throw in the towel when it comes to PragerU suing Google. They tend to throw in the towel when it comes to net neutrality. They throw in the towel when it comes to breaking up monopolies and antitrust legislation. All the conservatives today, I don't know about Ben Shapiro, but like Milo and a lot of others, they're all saying, yeah, push for antitrust against Facebook and YouTube. So where it counts, to me, the death of capitalism has always begun with people, usually Republicans, saying let's go after the big companies and keep them from getting too big. So even politically, Ben Shapiro is still not good enough. But
politics. So I don't know what his particular opinion on the Prager thing is, but I will ask him that.
Yeah. But the reason that we're always moving away from capitalism, the reason that we're still even having this debate of capitalism versus socialism, when we've all seen the picture of North and South Korea at night, some people older than me have seen East and West Berlin, we're still having this argument when the logistics side of economics have been settled even before the Communist Revolution. Capitalism so clearly raises everyone's standard of living. Why do we still keep moving away from capitalism is the ultimate question. So yeah, Ben Shapiro makes excellent pragmatic arguments for capitalism, why it works better. But ultimately, we just don't want to let businessmen be businessmen. Ultimately, we just don't trust selfish people. Selfish is still a dirty word. We still put Bernie Madoff in the same category as Steve Jobs. We still put criminals in the same category as perfectly honest businessmen. We still love to mock businessmen and we just don't trust anyone who's selfish. That's why, as much as we distrust the government, we keep on giving them more control of the economy, because we just can't stomach the idea of an economy unregulated.
Okay, so all that being said then, so now sell objectivism. Why is it the complete package that you believe it to be? And, you know, I've had your own Brooke on a couple times, who's the president of ARI.
Much better than I at the presenting at selling objectivism he is, but
that's what you're doing right now, really.
Yeah, well, yes, I'm trying. It's much easier to knock down what you disagree with, but so I read The Fountainhead.
That was the easy portion of the interview.
Yeah.
Now we're getting to
the let me take a sip of water.
Yeah, have a little water for guys.
Are we like 3 minutes into the hour? Just like 7 minutes in? So I read The Fountainhead, right? Again, I was a nihilistic, angry teen. I also had big dreams, though. I wanted to be a rock star. I loved music. I had this sort of, I took my nihilism and I wanted to make it into art. I wanted a good life, but I couldn't quite reconcile that with my negative, dark view of the world. So I read The Fountainhead, which is not a very political book. It touches upon politics a tiny bit, but it's mostly about an artist, an architect, and what he has to deal with in the social realm. Before you even get to politics, it's just how people treat you, how people treat him. And he's completely uncompromising. I remember just starting to read that book, and just a couple pages in, I just couldn't believe anyone was this much of a badass. I mean, the character and the author. I said, I've never met an adult that is capable of coming up with anything this cool. He's being reprimanded by the dean of his school, mm-hmm. and the dean's tells him he needs to pay attention to the traditional disciplines of architecture, and Howard Roark, the main character, says, he points to the window and he says, look at those people out there. I don't care what they think about architecture, so why should I care what their grandfathers thought? To me, I was just like, that was it. So,
well, for you, that's sort of like a direct throwaway of religion too, right?
Yeah.
Like, that was your parents' religion and your parents' parents and whatever.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, religion. And then, I mean, you find religion everywhere. You find people telling you in the so-called secular world, people saying you need to pay attention to what your ancestors believed and what they did. I mean, what is the alt-right if not a movement telling you that what your ancestors wore and the music they listened to and how they spent their time gives your life a purpose and meaning? Well, where did your ancestors get their identity from? Their parents before that? Like, it's just a giant evasion of reality. But The Fountainhead. It was just this Declaration of Independence. It was just so, it just spoke to me so personally, at such a deep level. I didn't really get the politics. That's not in The Fountainhead, but mm-hmm. I read that book, and later in the book, the main character is on trial, and he begins a speech by saying, thousands of years ago, somebody invented fire, and he was probably burnt at the stake that he showed his brothers how to light. That's poetry.
That's good.
I was just like, I just put the book down. I was like, everything's about to change. So I just, you know, by the time I was done with that book, I just said, all right, I want to know what else this author has to say. I may never be done picking at her brain. So I read Atlas Shrugged, which is much more focused on economics and politics, but still deeply personal. It really just kind of ties it all together. It really truly is a magnum opus. And yeah.
How do you think the left so effectively quash these ideas? Like, even, you know, I've had your own on. Met you. It was at an mm-hmm. Objectivist conference that mm-hmm. I spoke at. Yeah, I think you spoke too, didn't you? Or you hosted an event that night. You hosted like a talent show or something.
I hosted the talent show for the kids.
For the kids, showing that these people can actually be funny and talented. And
I mean, I was having fun. If people did see that, then that's great. But yeah.
But I think the left has been effective in basically making a complete mockery of these ideas.
Mm-hmm.
Which is why they've been unable to sort of mm-hmm. regenerate, maybe, since Ayn Rand disappeared. Not disappeared. She didn't galt. She died.
She did die, yes.
She disappeared. No.
Yes, no. What happened to her? Yeah, well, maybe.
That would have been good.
I haven't seen the body. Yeah. But so, yeah, the left, I mean, the academic world, which is synonymous with saying the left, has mostly ignored her. They mostly tried they penalized students for even mentioning her name. And then when she comes up, they mock her. The right wingers, the conservatives, they're condescending, really. They're just, you'll hear them say stuff like, oh yeah, sure, her books when I was a teenager, awesome. Like my neck beard fans talk about me. Like, oh, Rucka, I liked him. Then I turned 14. I mean, they talk about her like she isn't that much better than them, like she isn't that much more integrated. They don't want to debate her. The conservatives, guys like Dennis Prager, will not debate the ghost of Ayn Rand. He will not sit down with Yaron Brook or with any other objectivist.
I wonder if he won't. I mean, I'm friends with both of them. I'd be happy to invite them. You know what? I will invite them here. I'm saying it right now.
Ben Shapiro supposed to be debating Yaron? Wasn't that?
They've both agreed to it. We just have to figure it out. Ben said he would do it. He's
it's been
a
few months. I'm just saying. I tracked down Ben Shapiro. I got in his Q&A.
Yeah.
And I asked him. I said,
I know. I saw the video. Right.
So, I mean, it's been a while.
I can tell you that I have put them in touch over an mm-hmm. email, and,
cool.
and that they're welcome to do it here. So I suspect they will do it.
But I mean, so by and large, conservatives, they don't want to debate objectivists. Mm-hmm. And I don't know about if Ben Shapiro is intimidated. I don't think he is intimidated. He sees it as kind of irrelevant in my guess. But Dennis Prager is smart enough to see her as a threat. Dennis Prager is a guy who doesn't focus primarily on politics. He focuses primarily on ethics, mm-hmm. morality. That is his thing. And his whole shtick is that there can be no morality without God. I mean, you've seen the video that rustled everyone's jimmies. And sadly, most people didn't have a good answer to him. I've been doing commentary videos lately. I've got a few, and one of them is called The Moral Case Against Dennis Prager, where I sort of call him out on these things.
Did Did you see my sit down with him and Shermer? Because we did.
I tried watching it, and like 5 minutes in, the two of them are still going on about how students, they need their safe space, and there's not a safe space out in the real world. I'll give it another chance. I don't mean to be dismissive.
Give me a chance
you
here,
man. You worked hard on it.
Yeah, come on.
But honestly, I don't think the world needs to see a conservative and a skeptic sort out their differences. I'd like to see objectivism be challenged and ultimately debunked if it isn't true. It needs to be, people, they don't want to go near it. They don't want to challenge Ayn Rand. They act like she's not that important. So Dennis Prager. Sure. Dennis Prager's whole thing is like, no morality without God. Wouldn't you think he would then really give his time, the time of day to somebody who wrote so much about morality without God, somebody who made the point that morality is secular, that it's necessarily secular and scientific? So, I mean, I love Prager. I mean, I'm a fan of his work. I've enjoyed him. I read him earlier than I read Ayn Rand, and so he is like the Plato to my Aristotle. Mm-hmm. So Plato was Aristotle's teacher, and Aristotle rebelled, and he got rid of the mystical stuff, and he mostly said, hey, we're here on Earth, let's live here, and the purpose of morality is flourishing, personal flourishing, and that's ultimately where I ended up. But I mean, Prager was a big influence on my life, so I would very much like to see him go face to face with an objectivist. But not to be mean, but yeah. I do think he's avoided talking about Ayn Rand because he's either subconsciously or consciously afraid. He thinks his best bet is just to ignore her altogether.
Yeah, I suspect that he's probably actually not afraid of the conversation from everything that I know about him and when I sat with him and Shermer right here. Mm-hmm. But I will ask him. I mean,
yeah.
Isn't it interesting though when you sort of feel like, yeah, I can see a little bit of like, you feel slightly guilty having to call out someone that you basically like. And you're not putting him down, you're just saying.
Well, a little bit. I feel the guilt is not so much in calling anyone out, a little bit, but the guilt is really, I don't want to put words in Prager. If Prager's not actually afraid, if it's a genuine oversight on his part, then I hate to be sitting here and bad-mouthing him. I talked about this in my video. There's a lot of conservatives really don't want to really talk about Rand's ethics. She makes the case that ethics are secular. Ethics are selfish. Selfishness is a virtue. It's not even neutral. It's a virtue. Selfishness properly understood. And conservatives just they don't really want to hear it.
So in effect, that selfishness, mm-hmm. rational self-interest, that mm-hmm. doing good for yourself, mm-hmm. basically, which the average person thinks is selfish in the evil sense of the word, mm-hmm. but that doing good for yourself in effect is the most human thing you can do.
It's required to live. I mean, if we're in the jungle right now and it's 100,000 BC, like, we have to do a few things. We have to think rationally. Yeah, try being a mystic and surviving for very long. You've got to pay attention to the reality around you. You've got to produce, right? Plan things out, whether it's getting the predators away or building a house or whatever it is you have to do to survive. And you have to recognize that you did it. You have to be proud of it. You have to understand, I am good enough to exist. I am good enough to preserve my life.
Is that the one maybe that gets the left more than anything else?
Like pride?
Having value. Like feeling pride and having value in what you do. It's so not the way they operate these days. They want everyone to be, you should literally be shamed of your immutable characteristics if you behave in a way they don't want you to behave. Like having actual pride in what you do.
That's a tough one. The left.
An anathema to them.
They definitely, today, the left are so anti-egoist. They're so anti-individual that having pride in your own work. I mean, the left today are complete egalitarians, as in John Rawls' egalitarian. Just everyone's just lucky. Like you have this studio because you're lucky. Those swastikas you keep on that side of the room. Great move, by the way. Your luck. Everything you have is just luck. You were born with genes. You have an environment. You were this. That. It's like, so they're so anti-individualistic that of course pride is. Is a big no-no, but I mean, conservatives, especially the religious ones, they're just so anti-pride. They're just, I don't know. I don't know. Honestly, they're all anti whatever it is that Rand is peddling. The left and the right are both against it on a in a very fundamental way.
So is there anyone in the public space that you think is putting out these ideas effectively?
I think Yaron Brook is a godsend. It's unfortunate that if he gets hit by a bus, like it's pretty much over, because there's no one else on like on YouTube challenging students, going out, being charismatic that I've seen. I mean, there's a few others that I watch, but he's especially charismatic and just personable. I don't know. I mean, I guess me being here is sort of that. Yeah. I think it's kind of neat to be here as, you know, as an edgy guy, as somebody who's never been afraid to offend, as someone who's, you know, kind of down to earth, to be here saying it. It's not just an intellectual floating abstraction shit. It's for the everyman.
Yeah, I have to say, when we met and had lunch that day, you know, I was literally walking out of the hotel. You kind of grabbed me, and we went over for lunch. I didn't know what we were going to talk about, and then you started going into all this, and I was like, "Wait, this is the same guy that's making all those videos." Like, I really had no idea that you're thoughtful about all this stuff and sort of have this intellectual background. But correct me if I'm wrong, but I think you said to me that you were not ready to like come out as an atheist, as an objectivist.
I think speaking
at that time, well, like you didn't want people to fully only a couple months ago.
I've always been dragging my feet as far as just breaking character and just being who I am. I've been really disillusioned with watching you, watching Sargon, watching all the Gamergate people drift aimlessly, in my opinion. I know they're going to get mad. And by the way, nothing I've ever posted on in musical form is nearly as offensive as the things I'm saying today. Just so we're clear, the people are gonna get much more pissed off about this interview than anything I've ever posted before, and I'm aware of it. But people are, I'm just saying, in my estimation of things, you guys are drifting towards nationalism in some form, or some form of conservatism. And I saw Sargon sitting right here. Oh my God, what an honor.
Yeah.
Oh my God. I saw him on your show saying that, so someone in the super chat asked if he's ever read Rand. I always assumed he's one of these neckbeards that read Rand and, you know, took something away from it, but just kind of dismissed it. And no, he said, "Oh, I've never read it. I've never felt the need to. Those people go too far." So he's the other type of neckbeard, the type that won't even read her and already knows what she's about. So he was in town for VidCon, so I went and my friend Kirk scrambled to find a copy of this book called The Ominous Parallels, which is unbelievable. It's by Leonard Peikoff, who is Rand's like favorite student, I guess. Like, just he wrote this book kind of showing, it basically walks you through history, showing how philosophy shapes each era of history, and what led to Nazi Germany over the course of history philosophically, and then what America also is going through similar stages philosophically, which could lead to very undesirable results as well. So I thought that would be a great book to give Sargon, because even though it's not even by Rand, but I'd heard him talk about collectivism and individualism, a very rare thing to hear these days. And he was talking about how now we've got Nazis and communists fighting in the streets, like in Weimar Germany. So I was like, okay, this would be a good book. Gave it to him. He read it. He ended up reading an excerpt of it on his YouTube channel, and all the neo-Nazis started freaking out on him, yelling at him, "How can you read a book written by a Jew and trust them to tell you what Nazi Germany was all about?" Like, it's just, and he was really impacted by the book, and I ended up going on his podcast, the Thinkery, and just kind of grilling him. Eventually, by an hour in, I'm just grilling him, just saying like, "So what is it about this you can't swallow?" And and I was kind of doing that with you a little bit at lunch. And
I said to you, I'm pretty sure the exact thing I said to you, which is, "There's nothing about this that I don't like." I mean, you know, I'm one of the only people that put you crazy people on a show. You know, I had not only your own book, but Don Watkins, who co-wrote the book. I mean, I love these ideas.
Yeah.
I love these ideas, couched in also that I'm talking about the politics of the day and classical liberalism.
Well, they're all tied together.
Yeah.
But you call yourself a classical liberal. I call you a classical progressive. I mean, you're pushing for institutions that the radical progressives of 100 years ago brought us, public education, remnants, signs of socialized medicine, the, you know, basic safety net, all these things that didn't exist, at least
so,
not.
So my feeling on all of those, yeah. And this is, you know, when I've had the ANCAPs sit mm-hmm. here in that very chair,
yeah.
is that I can go, intellectually, I can go down that road, as you mm-hmm. said before, you gotta take everything to its end conclusion. Yeah. And I really do like the intellectual exercise of doing mm-hmm. all that stuff. I just don't know that you can, that the system is now so big, I don't know that you can unfurl now or roll back so much of it without actually destroying the entire thing.
Mm-hmm.
And I think actually what we have here for all its flaws is pretty decent.
Yeah, it is decent. I mean, in the scope of history, you and I are living a fantasy, absolutely. I mean, just this right here is science fiction. Yeah. But look, I mean, people focus.
So I would say I just take a slightly more realistic approach.
I think you're okay. You're focused on politics entirely too much, which is something which is very American. Again, like I said earlier, Americans are so compartmentalized. They think ethics are over here and politics are over there. And if we ever are gonna see laissez-faire capitalism, I pronounced that right. Yeah, you would think at this point I could pronounce it. But,
yeah.
The only way we'll ever actually see it is if there's an ethical revolution, philosophical revolution. If Ayn Rand is embraced, you'll start to see us move gradually towards the type of society that I would like to see. But no, the reason, again, libertarians can never get more than 10% of the vote is because there's a lot to get into with libertarians, but if your only focus is politics, a culture needs to be ready for it. A culture needs to embrace egoism. They need to stop hating businessmen. They need to stop hating bankers. They need to embrace individualism, embrace rational selfishness, and then the politics will eventually reflect that. But I was mainly trying to get to the bottom of you, not in the scope of politics, which I think I even told you. I said, like, it's not even about politics. It's about philosophy. And I want to understand you because, again, as a displaced lefty, as I call you guys, like, why is it you guys would rather drift towards this conservative type, conservatarian mixed economy?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I can scream and jump and tell you it's only going to lead to more statism, but whether or not you take my word for it, like, why is it you guys are more comfortable drifting towards some form of conservatism or something other than what it is that Rand was pushing? And I think it's really difficult to it's an overhaul of everything that people are used to believing and used to thinking, and it is all or nothing, and. You know,
that's what I'm saying,
yeah.
is that in an all or nothing game,
I mean,
that we could blow up this system,
mm-hmm.
even if you were right about everything you're saying.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? If every philosophical notion that you just laid out is 100% right,
mm-hmm.
getting to any of that, I think, would be, at the very least, it would be a revolution.
Yeah.
That most likely would be bloody because all revolutions are pretty bloody.
Yeah, that's a cliche. It would be a slow. It would be a gradual political change, but the biggest revolution would be internal. It would be in your life and how enriched your life would become as a result of embracing yourself, of being proud of yourself with no reservation, with no unearned guilt whatsoever. And that's what it is that objectivism is really about. That's why the Fountainhead is a great place to start, because it's the Fountainhead is for people that are not completely cynical yet, who do believe in the personal pursuit of values and want to read a great book. And you just start with that. And that's what really it's about. And yeah, politically, you know, guys like you and Sargon are still more comfortable doing the pragmatist thing and saying, okay, let's just do what works. I mean, ethics are great, but let's really just focus on what works. And, you know, and I can tell you, oh God, but you don't understand, pragmatism is not pragmatic and it's not going to lead anywhere positive. And you're still going to say, yeah, but I'm just one man, what can I possibly do? And what you can do, David, is you can take my hand and together we can find Atlantis.
Yeah, you do a hell of a sell job there, and I think the voices definitely help.
Well, it's all about the voices.
Yeah, but I'm not with you on that. This is it's just this floating thing out there that isn't in and of itself causing good. I think the amount of people that now watch things like this and watch mm-hmm. things like Sargon and many others that are waking up to the general ideas of liberty mm-hmm. and individualism and a lot of the stuff that you do like there.
Yeah.
Listen, take as many of them as you can.
I mean, listen.
You know, get going.
I'm pretty serene about other people. I realize I can't control people, and I'm not even that interested in even convincing anyone of anything, to be honest. This is really just me expressing myself. But as far as where society is heading, I do believe we are moving towards this, I hate to use the word, sort of fascist destination.
Well, I agree with the idea that we're sort of caught between these two things right now, which is what has become the mainstream left and pretty much just Trumpism. So I wouldn't say it's that Spencer thing necessarily that you mentioned before, but it's Trumpism. Mm-hmm. The two forces right now are the Trump force and the left force. Out of those two, I mean, for me personally, I think the leftism and collectivism is a much bigger threat to actual humanity than what Trump is.
Yes, but
that may be a false choice.
Look, so Trump is a nationalist, which pretty much describes virtually all conservatives today. I mean, all conservatives, they talk about nationalism like it's being true to America's founding principles when the opposite is true. Anyone who is, I mean, nationalism is another progressive thing. The early progressives came up with nationalism. It's like the conservatives pick up everything that the left discards. It really is remarkable. I don't always agree with Michael Malice. He's an anarchist, but he says conservatives are just progressives that are driving the speed limit. And I think he's absolutely right about that.
So what do you disagree with a guy like Malice on then?
He's an anarchist. That's what I disagree with.
And how is that so far different?
It's all the difference in the world. If you don't have a government protecting your rights, then it just becomes, they're just competing factions, competing gangs.
So, but then in a situation like Google, as we were talking about before, you want the government to have nothing to do with it, though.
Well, I don't want the government to force anyone to do anything, but if, for instance, Google's headquarters were broken into, or if a hacker was stealing something from Google, or redesigning their website against whatever it is, or posting horrendous...
So you don't think you can privatize that stuff, that sort of
force, violence needs to be the exclusive domain of the government, and the government then can only be limited to its proper function of protecting individual rights. So the minute you give the government this much to start engineering society, to start deciding, well, what's best for everyone, you are paving the way for an enormous lobby system, and this is not even a slippery slope argument. This is clearly what has happened. Our government was never entirely individualistic. It was never entirely limited to what it is that I'm saying, but it was almost there in the 19th century.
So if we could just get back to what the founders wanted and get back
founders,
to those, because the documents themselves are pretty spectacular.
They are. Oh, and in the context of history, to have a document saying that you have the right to life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness, that the government is here to protect your rights rather than to
give them to you.
To give them to you,
yeah.
Is unbelievable. And the founding fathers are innovators of fucking Elon Musk status, but
you think they'd all be rolling over in their graves right now?
They probably would, but here's the thing. So this is something Yaron Brooks says: the founding father, this country is the greatest country ever, built on quicksand. So the reason that the founding fathers and all the other Enlightenment thinkers weren't ever able to preserve the Enlightenment is because of the branch of philosophy that is ethics. They had a scientific view of the world when it came to, you know, existence, metaphysics, and epistemology. Science was the way. When it came to politics, they said, hey, let's be individuals. Let's let everyone pursue the best life they can. Capitalism, boom, industrial revolution comes along. The slaves are freed. All these things are happening that just the middle class comes out of nowhere. There was never such a thing as a middle class going back a couple hundred years. So the world just becomes unrecognizably just heaven on earth. But ethically, the Enlightenment thinkers, as far as I know, they never had a substitute for the ethics of religion, the ethics of altruism. Jesus nailed to a cross was still seen as the moral ideal. And that's the reason that capitalism could never be preserved, because ethics is what shapes a culture. I mean, philosophy in general, but people are driven by their ethical beliefs. And again, that's why capitalism keeps losing. That's why we keep moving away from it. And it was Ayn Rand that came along and completed what the Enlightenment thinkers began, really completed what Aristotle began all that time ago, which is saying, yeah, life is here on Earth. Life, things exist, and we learn about them scientifically. Politically, it ought to be individual, completely individualistic and have individual freedom, but ethics, let's talk about ethics, she said. She said, why is altruism the moral ideal? Who said? Jesus? Who, like Plato? Who? Where did you get this from? Your mother? Society? Who told you that giving, sacrificing, especially the more you suffer, the better it is, and doing anything for yourself all falls into this category of selfishness? Why? She said, why? And that's the question that really pisses people off. That's the part of her that really makes people hate her. The reason Rand is hated is not because of her economics. I mean, people don't hate libertarians. They don't hate Ron Paul. They don't hate Gary Johnson. Mm-hmm. People think those guys are cool, right? But Ayn Rand, those are fighting words to even bring her up. And it's the ethics. It's the fact she really gets down to people's deepest values. And ironically enough, she's just telling people, live the life that you want. It's your life. Do it for you and think about it. Be rational about it. Think about the kind of life that you want. Advocate for a political system that allows you to do what you want and live the best life that you can, because life is finite.
Yeah. It's interesting. So this thing about that you know, Sargon and me and this crew are floating out here. I mean, yeah. Everything you just said right there, that mm-hmm. last two sentences at least, is exactly what I've been talking about here for the last 2 years.
Okay. I'm trying to think of an example. It was like a gotcha moment to say, yeah, I mean,
well, yes, we can argue about, well, yes, I do believe, look, yeah. I come from I went to SUNY Binghamton, State University of New York, and mm-hmm. I had public education from kindergarten all the way up. Mm-hmm. I believe the state can do some of those things effectively. The state may have grown too out
they
of control,
can only,
the Department
yeah.
of Education may be too big and all of those things. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's out of the purview of what the state can do effectively. Could you roll back some of that stuff? Yeah, and I'd be interested in defunding a lot of these things so that we can kind of figure
well, why,
it out.
Why stop there? But,
so I get what your argument is. You want to just mm-hmm. go to the end. You want to go to the end.
I want to do what's right. And giving the government power they don't have is in itself corrupt. It's not that politicians are corrupted by D.C., them having power that they're not supposed to have is a form of corruption. It is evil. And giving the government power that it should not have, power beyond protecting your rights as an individual, they can only fund these programs by taking money away from people that don't want to give it to them.
Yeah.
Even if people do want to give them that money, that doesn't give them the right to now make their neighbor pay for it as well.
Listen, I'm for mm-hmm. cutting taxes on everybody.
So am I.
Yeah, I mean, stop giving the government so much power. The only way you can stop yeah. doing that is by stop giving it so much money.
They might still find a way to hold us down.
It's a good start.
I mean, look, maybe there's a disconnect between ethics and politics, but I mean, in the minds of some. But look, I like the cut of your jib. I'm not here to grill you. Although
yeah.
People will think I'm just here trying to convert you.
We're having
a discussion.
By the way,
we want to know what you think. Leave us a comment down below, and Dave is going to read and reply to all your comments. This is true.
You've been doing this YouTube game for a while.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. I guess I have been.
Yeah.
Some would say.
I didn't know how deep we were going to go on all this. You were ready to go.
Yeah. I mean, every time I watch your show, I always end up like getting distracted by what I would say.
Yeah.
So I end up, I have to rewind and kind of go back because I missed what you guys were saying because I was just thinking about what I wanted to say. So yeah, it is cool to have this conversation.
Well, what's interesting to me is that mm-hmm. all of the things that you've said here mm-hmm. with the passion that you have mm-hmm. and obviously the intellectual acumen that you possess, mm-hmm. you got to go be that person then.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, isn't this everything you've... If everything you said has any worth, it's like, well, get working, man.
Yeah, yeah.
Absolutely. And I guess that's the purpose of being here right now, right?
It's the purpose of being here. It's the purpose of working on my music, on working on anything, of, you know, hanging with friends, dating, whatever it is, like of pursuing values. So, yeah, it is. I mean, it is about just living the best life you can. And, you know, it is fantastic.
Do you feel you do that all the time? Live the best life that you can?
I would say I try. You know, I'm 6 years sober. I've taken my life very seriously. I've really, really worked on reaching my full potential. I want to be brand new, you know? Like, no. It really is all or nothing, which, the alcoholic part of me, it is very compatible with this philosophical worldview. It is all or nothing. Because if you're not building, then you're you're falling apart. If you're not moving in a positive direction, you're basically drifting in a negative direction. I'll try to think of some better metaphors later, but
send me a couple.
After. Yeah, absolutely. But yeah, I mean, reconciling objectivism with recovery, you know, the 12-step program and recovery in general has been, it's definitely been something I've been focused on the last few years, and there's not a whole lot out there reconciling the two. So it might just be something I end up linking up with others to really work on. And a lot of objectivists, they just kind of dismiss the 12-step program wholesale that I've seen, which I think is wrong. I don't agree with them. I think they're a little bit too dismissive. But yeah, there's I guess a lot to get into there.
Yeah, I gotta say, throughout this whole interview, I've had a feeling, I don't know if you saw my original interview with Colin Moriarty.
Maybe.
From way back when, and it was during YouTube week also, and I thought we were gonna talk about video games the whole time.
Oh yeah.
And I kind of thought we were gonna talk about parody video. I mean, thought we were talking about video games a little bit more, and Gamergate and some other stuff. But I remember during the interview with him, I kept thinking, I mean, this guy knows what he believes. He knows what's in his mind, and he's gonna do great things. And he's basically blown up since then.
Yeah, so well, good for him. Perhaps. I like him. I met him and you at one of your panels here in town, and he said something during the panel that I just
He brought up Ayn Rand during that.
He said something I disagree with. So I'm, you know, since he's not here right now, I'll just correct him on his behalf. He said,
I could bring you on once a week to just correct.
I mean, we are going to be here all next week. Join us Wednesday with Dave. You can chance to win that basketball. Leave us a comment for the chance to win your own, very own basketball. He said he brought up 1984 and Atlas Shrugged, and he said, "How did these authors know what would happen? Because these novels are coming true, right? Atlas and 1984, they are coming true. How do they know?" And Colin answered his own question and said, "Because it's human nature, and these authors understood that that's human nature, and we just need to try to stop it." And no, Ayn Rand was not saying it's human nature to drift towards dystopia. It's not human nature to destroy values. The opposite is true. Human nature, the tools we have for survival are to think, to be rational, to produce, to trade, and to be proud, to have self-esteem, to pursue self-esteem. And that's what she was basically saying. She was saying, if we get rid of rationality, if we get rid of rational egoism or never embrace it, if we do away with reality altogether and we don't pay attention to reality, Atlas Shrugged will come true, is what she was saying, in my understanding. So it's not that it's just, so this vision of human nature as a primarily negative thing is what we need to dispel. If you want to make the world a better place, let's carve a stake through the heart of cynicism. If anyone's a writer out there, write characters that pursue values, that stand proud and are confident to live on Earth. Create beautiful things. Just don't go around saying that mankind's destiny is just to destroy himself. That's just bullshit. And it's not true. Look at the face of your baby and tell your baby that it's his destiny to destroy himself and everyone around him. Who the hell wants to think that? It's just there's no evidence of that. It's just this dark view of life that we just kind of seem to take for granted. It's just perpetuated by cynics around us, and it's not true. So that ultimately it does boil down to cynicism versus egoism versus pursuit of values. And again, that's why I keep bringing up The Fountainhead as just the greatest life-changing book that I ever read.
I wish I could have got you to open up during this interview.
You know, I'll try next time.
I can't tell what you think about anything.
Yeah.
There's the inherent problem.
That's my problem too. I have no idea what I think.
It's been a pleasure, man.
Yeah,
we'll do this in a year from now and keep the conversation going.
Well, you got that card right there.
I didn't even look at it once.
Yeah, well, now I'm curious.
Sure we did all right here. Let's see.
Curious. What, two cards.
You know what? We're not going to talk about demonetization.
Oh.
You know what?
Yeah,
YouTube,
you know what?
It's YouTube week, so let's just do a quick 2 minutes on YouTube in general.
Pour me some water.
I'm going to pour you some water.
Okay.
Talk to me about just what being a YouTube creator these days. What does that mean to you?
Listen, the apocalypse happens. Where do I even begin? People are too, look, the best thing anyone can advocate for, again, is a free market. Okay, it's the free market that brought us YouTube in the first place. It's the free market and flow of capital that made it profitable. I'm old school. You know, I'm a 2008 YouTuber, so to me it's weird that anyone makes a whole lot of money on YouTube. But I mean, just kind of bear through this and have you noticed that YouTubers are the only people allowed to be selfish? YouTubers are the only businessmen that are allowed to demand money for what they work on. Can you imagine if a pharmaceutical company were complaining about that they haven't made profits this year? By the way, can you imagine if PewDiePie wasn't a YouTuber? Like if you just heard a 20-some-year-old multimillionaire got called a Nazi by the Wall Street Journal and he lost a bunch of brand deals or lost a bunch of money, would you feel bad? Mm-hmm. Because our culture, again, we hate businessmen. We hate anyone who appears to be selfish. We especially don't trust big business. We don't trust the very rich. People would say, all right, so some super rich guy got fucked over by the media. Ah, they were probably right anyway. He's that rich. He's probably racist. And whoever got rich without fucking over somebody. So yeah, we have this cynical distrust of businessmen in general. So. I don't know if any of that sort of addressed demonetization. It is bullshit. It's clearly disorganized. My opinion of YouTube has always been that they're asleep at the wheel. Although it does appear that they are targeting points of view they disagree with. I can understand why that seems to be the case for someone like you. At the same time, it does seem to be that they're asleep at the wheel. And I would just, I would call attention to it, absolutely. Yeah.
For the record, they have, the last month or two, maybe 2 months, they have loosened the chains on us a little bit, so it seemingly has gotten a little bit better. Mm-hmm. But I think my issue with them is, look, they're a private company, they can do whatever the hell they want.
Yeah.
And nobody's forcing me to be on YouTube, and I have to, as a businessman and as someone that created this, I got to figure out other ways to make profits and have different revenue streams and all that stuff. But that being said, I would like a little more transparency. So that, I think, is what you're
You guys are fighting the battles that I was never brave enough to fight or just never had the time for. Like, you guys taking on the social justice left, going people that are going into Antifa's events, for lack of a better word, and facing them and going after YouTube for their clearly biased practices. You guys have my deepest respects, even if I disagree with most of you on many things. you guys are very courageous, and there's poetry in the fact that you guys are, many of you, former lefties. That you guys are the people who just a few years ago would have mocked someone like me if you heard my opinions. And there's going to be some people still doing that. Make no mistake, but. It's just there's something very pretty about the fact that the left has broken off. It's just, but again, it's the question of where is everyone heading? Where's everyone going to end up? And I'm none too optimistic.
It's interesting because you could almost make the a sort of similar argument from earlier where you said it's capitalism versus everything. Mm-hmm. I would say at this point it's the left versus everything. That we can agree and disagree on this or that, or about public education, or I don't know what your thoughts are on abortion or whatever else. But whatever it is, it doesn't even matter. Mm-hmm. It's basically this huge wide net is forming that's just, it's anti what the modern left is.
Yeah.
And we may disagree on some of these things, but okay, thing on freedom.
You should watch my commentary videos.
I'll check them out.
Channel is Rucka Reacts. They could be a little bit long, but I mean, I think I address what's happening in the landscape today in a way that I haven't seen a lot of, at least objectivists, really address. Being anti-social justice isn't being for something.
Uh-huh.
And ultimately, being anti-communist doesn't mean you're going to end up somewhere positive. Being anti-Islam or a form of Islam ultimately isn't going to get you anywhere. You need to be for something positive. So yeah, it is about the pursuit of positive values that will make your life a better and the world a better place.
That is how you end an interview. It's been a pleasure, my friend. For more on Rucka, and you can make your hair higher for the next one.
I'm going to try.
I want it higher.
I think it will be.
Yeah?
If it's in a year from now, absolutely.
No haircuts.
No haircuts.
All right. For more on Rucka, check him out right here on the YouTube at youtube.com/itsrucka.